canola in the field, and then you have Jerry talking about gardening and all that stuff. All these issues come back to chemical use. Like synthetic chemicals that we can make in a factory, we have to prevent that in our life. So it's used in production, and once we use chemicals in production, like the chemical fertilizers and all the insecticides, fungicides that we kill with, they all affect the quality. It decreases the quality of the food we eat. That's why organic food is good. And then once the food is harvested on the farm, it goes to the factory, the food processing. And then we have added to the food and drinks all the artificial flavors, colors, and preservatives. And like that's the list of the E's on the right-hand side. That's the dirty dozen that you have to avoid in your food because all the artificial colors are dangerous for our body. But our regulators still allow it in our food. Like in Europe, a lot of chemicals have already been taken out, while we still get it. So we have to stop the added chemicals to food and drinks. And then in body care products, stop all the chemicals in the body care, because everything you smear on your body goes into the body and can create problems. And then in medicine, all the medicines that are being put down, you think, oh, it's for your health or to get better. But like all those synthetic chemicals from all those different sources is a big cocktail. And in our body, we get that cocktail. That cocktail has never been regulated by officials. Nobody has done research to the cocktails. That's why we get now so sick. And each generation gets more sick because the cocktail gets heavier and heavier. So how can we stop the cocktail? And like these are some suggestions, like Dr. Carol Harford, the good health in the 21st century. If you Google those names, you find their answers to the good stuff. And Sue Dengay with Fed Up, Children's Behavior, linking children's behavior with the wrong foods, all the food additives, etc. So these are very good books to start with family life to get you back on track to prevent problems. So now we talk about the complex self-regulating biological systems. Like our body is self-regulating, used to be, in a healthy body. Everything is happening in our body to heal ourselves. The paddocks, your garden, in the soil in the field is self-regulating. If we have all the microbiology, all the biology in the soil working, then it regulates to soil health and it regulates to prevention disease in plants, etc. And the systems are so complex that we can't quantify all those links with science. Science can't measure all those entities. So everything we know with science is only a part of the whole system. So we can't get the whole system quantified. That's why the way I talk and the way people here talk about organics, you have to believe it. You see it and you believe it. You don't need an explanation, because science can't give explanations. Because shapes and relationships in nature are not in fixed patterns. Everything is changing. Because the biology, the light, the water, the food, everything is changing all the time. And when we insist on controlling nature, we are interfering with nature's rhythms. And like all those synthetic chemicals interfere with the natural patterns, and our self-healing in the body is stopped by those chemicals. So if we then start with food processing, like the main objective is convenience and ease of use in the packaging and eating, in looks and taste. And as we want to increase shelf life, the food processors kill life in the food. All the bacteria are killed in the food. So we get that food on our shelf and that lasts longer. So we have to be very careful with the food processing. So how to make healthy food choices? Well, as we learn, like with here this Organic Expo, lots of people talk and you can, in the various stands, you can see the good food. If you become aware of it, you can do it with gardening, shopping, preparing and eating. Starting the good life from the plate. And local food, the more closer the food comes from, the better it is, because the freshness is very important with food as well. So then we go to the gene, because the GM is all the genes, gene manipulation. And like the DNA is the language of life. And like this double helix, the DNA was 50 years ago described by two scientists in England. And then everybody thought, oh, the genes are hardwired. We know exactly if you have that gene in your body, you will get that and that in the future. But 50 years later, we know the genes are not hardwired. The DNA is not hardwired. It's in each cell of a plant, it's in each cell of our body, but the genes can change, the DNA can change. So what do genes tell us? Well, the DNA doesn't tell us how it works. Because now the science has discovered that genes have a memory. And that memory tells which genes are active and which genes are not active. And that memory is inheritable. Like we all know, our children have the genes of the father and the mother. But it also has the memory bank of the father and mother at the time of conception. So the baby that's born is not the baby that we were born like 30, 50, 60 years ago, no. The baby is born with the health of the parents at the time of conception. That's why we go so back in steps with any generation now, any generation, every next generation becomes worse in health. So, and of course, we can climb up that ladder again by preparing our body before conception and do a body cleanse and start with the good food, and then the baby is healthier again than the parents were. And if you're interested in that, you can Google Dr. Pottinger, P-O-T-T-E-N-G-E-R, because Dr. Pottinger describes that with cat study he did. And if you want other information, you can always come later to me for Ask Other Connections. Because there's crosstalk between the genes and the environment. Like between our body and the environment we live in. In our house, the food we eat, the drinks we take. And the conditions of that gene determine the gene expression. So genes, so if we start eating fast food, and like fast food is not only the food from the fast food restaurants, it's also that you go to a supermarket and you buy all that overprocessed packages, you go home and you can make a meal in 10 minutes. That's also fast food. In all that food, if you eat that, then most of the bugs in our gut don't have to work because it's easy digested and goes away. So then those genes go to sleep. And then for the next generation, the genes are to sleep for the child as well. But genes are switching on and off, and that's epigenetics. And with that switching on and off, in the genes, it's a biochemistry factor. And in that biochemistry, in the DNA, there are some chemical codes on the gene. So that gene doesn't work anymore. And it's all fantastic research that's being done in the epigenetics. If you are a Googler, if you Google epigenetics, you can learn more. So the current generation influences the next generation. So we have now to start the good work to get our children, our grandchildren, on the path back to better health. How do we do that? Like, this is the DNA story. Who sees something different in this picture? One big bee in the middle. Like, this is the queen bee. And the queen bee has exactly the same DNA as all the worker bees. So why is that bee like twice the size? Because it got special food. And that special food made the gene expression in the DNA that she became the queen. That's the gene expression, that's epigenetics. That's why we all have to be careful and really listen here. Of course, here I talked to the converted in the Organic Expo, but it's very important for you to realize that aspect. The DNA can be changed. The genes stay the same in the body, but the activities are changed. And in the breeding, the gene technology and the GM, like GM is then the genetically modified crops, we insert the desirable gene, a foreign gene, plus a virus and an antibiotic gene in the DNA of a host embryo. And of course, many people say, like with the wheat study, that the gene for the more fiber in the wheat comes from oats, and oats can't be dangerous, so GM wheat is safe. But they can only get the oats gene in the wheat with the virus gene and the antibiotic gene. And those genes are at the virus level and the bacterial level. And those genes can hop to other bacteria very easily. So in our gut, those genes from the antibiotic bacteria gene in the GM food can hop into our gut bacteria and live there. And then it's, of course, that's followed by the crossing and selection for the desired foreign gene in that stuff. But the forced entry, like, and you hear people on television saying, oh, this is just an extension of the breeding we have been doing for 8,000 years. Humans have modified genes for 8,000 years. This genetically modified is just a next step. It's wrong. What we have done in the past is all natural or help of chemicals. It's changing the DNA in the embryo. It's not transporting a foreign gene mechanically into a host. It's completely not natural. It's not what we always did, what our forebears did, not at all. And that forced entry of a foreign gene into the host DNA is very unstable. all the energies are loose, so the gene can disappear from that host very quickly. So that's why, like, if it gets into the gut and it can escape that in that foreign environment to a new host, it will do it. And then the GM we produce, and of course, as that foreign gene comes into the host, you get epigenetic reactions. The genes that are surrounding that foreign gene start to react to that foreign invader. And they can then create new proteins, new stuff in our body as a protection. So we create new proteins and toxins in our body that were never there before. Don't believe this, the breeders say, oh, it's natural, it can always happen. Because genetics looks for problems to use the technology for. So now they have a technology, they can play with genes, and now they look for problems, oh, what can we use to use that technology for? And then the first ones were herbicide tolerance and insect resistance. Like, that's for farming, to make farming easier. You can spray a crop with a herbicide, and you don't kill the crop, but you kill all the weeds. That's the story. And with insecticide resistance, like what we grow in Australia with GM cotton, then you can, the cotton doesn't have to be sprayed with insecticide, because the toxin in the weed, in the cotton, the insect gene in the GM cotton protects the plant from insects. But it's only like 80% of the insects that are deterred from eating that plant. Other insects can still eat that BT cotton, the GM cotton. So these are the helpers for the farmers. But now, like in the United States, and they say, oh, it's higher yields and it's better this, better that. But in the United States, after 10 years of use of BT, of GM crops in the United States, the United States Department of Agriculture, the top body in the United States, the government organization for agriculture, a big GM promoter always, in the back pages of their website, you can find a document, the first decade of GM in the United States. And in that document, they state, our yields now are not higher than they would have been without GM. Our chemical use now is not lower than it would have been without GM. The profits per hectare now for the farmer are not higher than they would have been without GM. The only reason why our farmers are using GM is ease of management, convenience, ease of use.